This talk is about instrument and method parameter optimization. So when you do an SRM experiment, what you want to gain is sensitivity and also accuracy and precision. And for doing that, you need to take into account several parameters. Some of them are in red, are related with the instrument. And some of them, and the other important part of the experiment, it's also the LC system that we have in front of the instrument, which is also very important in this type of experiment. So here you have a schema of a triple quadrupole, and you see that there are different potentials, like the collision energy that we apply to fragment the peptides, the clustering potential, and some other potential. And if you try to optimize these parameters, you can increase the sensitivity of a particular analyte. But at the end, well, sometimes we have experiments that in which you are monitoring very few analytes, and some of them are very low abundant, and maybe you are really interested in optimizing these parameters. But sometimes also it can happen that you have a high throughput experiment and you are not so interested, or you cannot afford to optimize all the parameters for all the analytes, because all these optimizations are time consuming and also sample consuming. So sometimes this is a limitation that you cannot overcome, and you don't optimize the parameters, okay? But you need to know that this optimization can be done, and in a particular case, it can be useful. Okay? So the collision energy is it's a difference of potential that we use to break the peptides. And for each peptide, a skyline, for example, gives a different value for collision energy that depends on the mass and on the charge. So the higher the energy, the more the peptide breaks, and the values can vary between manufacturers. Okay. Also, it can depend on the collision gas that you're using, the pressure of the gas that you have, the design of the collision cell. Several factors can affect this value. Okay. We saw yesterday during the tutorial this formula that it's in a skyline. This is for the 5,500 Qutra, in which we have this slope and intercept that goes into this formula to calculate the collision energy. And we have one equation for charge 2 and one equation for charge 3. This is similar in other instruments, and they are usually divided also by the charge of the peptide. Okay? So you can do a collision energy optimization experiment, which we will see also in the tutorial this afternoon, in which you acquire the data from your peptide using different collision energies. So you use the central default value, and then you choose some step counts that it can be, for example, in this case, is 5. So at the end, you have 5 experiments with a higher collision energy and 5 experiments with a lower collision energy. And you need to decide also the step count. If, for example, that formula tells you that the optimal collision energy for this peptide is 30, you can choose a step count of 2. And then you will try 30, 32, 34, 36, and so on. And it can happen, like in this case, that you do the optimization and the sensitivity, the maximum sensitivity is achieved with the default value. This is something that happened. But it can also happen that doing this optimization, you have another value, which is not the one that has been calculated with the formula that we have, that it's better. Okay? This is a new feature in Skyline 2.6. You can also store the information of your optimization values and create a library in order to apply these values for future experiments. And this is also something that we will see this afternoon. But as I told you before, this type of experiments are time and sample consuming, and also they are ideally performed not only with the synthetic peptides, but with the synthetic peptides in the real background that you are going to measure the sample. So at the end, you are consuming samples. That sometimes is a limiting factor. And as you have seen before, you can maybe you need 11 injections to optimize the parameters. So sometimes this is not possible. And this is another figure taken from an article from Paola Picotti, in which she was doing this type of experiments. And what she realized is that at the end, the gain in sensitivity is, in most of the cases, not so big. So maybe 50% gain of sensitivity. So depending on the type of molecules that you are monitoring, maybe you don't need this step. But if you are interested in a particular peptide that you know is very low abundant and you need to increase the signal, then maybe this is your experiment. What you need to take into account also when you do a collision energy optimization experiment is that the relative intensities that you get in a NMS2 spectrum, for example, in this case, you see that you have this ion, which is the most intense, then this is the second one, the third one, and so. And this is illustrated in the skyline figure. These relative intensities of the different ions from the peptide can change when you change the collision energy. And in a skyline, this is this parameter, which is the dot product, which correlates the intensity that you see in the SRM experiment with the intensity that you should expect in the compared with the MS2 spectrum from the library. And you need to be careful because, for example, in this case, in which we have applied the default value, the dot product is very good, the correlation is very good, it's 0.92. But if we apply minus 10, well, we lose sensitivity, so this is we are not going to choose this value, but you see also that the correlation is not that good. So the relative intensities, you can also see in the figures, are changing. So for example, the yellow one in here is the third one, and in here is the second more intense. So this is something that you need to be aware of also. Another potential that you can optimize, and also in Skyline, it gives you the chance to do a ramp of values to optimize the value for each peptide, is that the clustering potential. That the clustering potential is a difference between the potential between the skimmer and the orifice. And it's used to minimize the cluster ions that are formed between the analyte and the solvent. So also you need to be careful with that because very high the clustering potential can cause fragmentation on the analyte, okay? And this is related to the flow of the LC and to the peptide sequence. So if you want to optimize, it's enough that you optimize for one transition for each peptide because the optimal value will be the same for all the transitions, okay? There are other potentials that can be changed in the instrument, but they depend more on the instrument than on the analyte. So in general, we don't use to change it. But again, if you have a very special case with a very low abundant peptide that you are super interested in, maybe you want to play a bit with these parameters to try to increase the sensitivity. Well, yesterday we were seeing a lot of things about cycle time. So you, I think you already know what is cycle time. So as Brendan was saying, we are doing a chromatography-based quantitation. So we have a signal. And we are not monitoring the signal continuously because we have hundreds of transitions. So we do first one, then the second, and so. So at the end, we need to reconstruct the signal from the data points that we have. So what is very important is that the frequency of the data acquisition is appropriate to the signal that we have. Because, for example, in here we have a high frequency, we have a lot of points to reconstruct the signal, and in each of the figures we have less points. And if now we reconstruct the signal from these data points, we see that in here we are very close to the reality, but in here that we have so few points, we have a reconstruction that it's not real at all, no? So that's why it's so important, the cycle time, which, as we said yesterday, is the time needed to acquire all the transitions in our method and affects a lot in the quantitation accuracy. Okay, you see in here another example in which we try to reconstruct the signal that we have with a different frequency of data sampling and how it changed the area under the curve of this peak, you see? And how we calculate this cycle time? Well, the cycle time is the dwell time multiplied by the number of transitions that we are monitoring. And this will depend on the number of peptides and also the number of transitions per peptide that we choose. So we usually choose between 4 and 5, but I mean, if you want to include more, then the cycle time will increase also. Okay? Well, we saw yesterday, the ones that came with me to the instrument, that this is not completely true because we need some time in the instrument to change from transition to transition. So this is an estimation of the cycle time, but it's always longer than this because of this extra time that you need to switch between transitions. So here we have also some examples. For example, this is the ideal case in which we have few transitions with high dwell time. So the cycle time is short and we can reconstruct very well the signal. In here we have another example in which we have more transition with the same dwell time, and then we have a higher cycle time and the quantitative results are poorer, because we have less data points per peak. But if we say, okay, we have more transition, let's put less dwell time, then what happened is that we have the same cycle time, so the reconstruction will be fine, but we have lower signal to noise and higher limits of detection, so we lose some sensitivity. So we need to achieve a compromise between the number of transitions that we want to monitor, the dwell time, the cycle time, and all these things. Another example in which we have a peak. In this method, we were monitoring 120 transitions, and the peak width was 12 seconds. So if we have a dwell time of 10 milliseconds, you see that we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 points, and we can reconstruct well this peak. And when we increase the dwell time, we have less data points, and at the end we have a triangle. So that's not so nice for quantitation. So one thing that you will see in future tutorials and that we discussed also yesterday in front of the instrument, that is that you don't need to acquire all the transitions all the time, because you have some prior information, which is the retention time in which your peptide comes out, and you can limit the acquisition of certain transitions to a window around the retention time of your peptide. And this, depending on the gradient length and the peak width, with this we can increase the number of transitions by a factor of 5 to 20 without a decrease in dwell time or sensitivity. So if you are monitoring lots of transition, it is highly recommended that you use this schedule SRM mode. So the only thing is that then your chromatography needs to be very reproducible, and well, you will see also that there are some tools that can help with that, as a retention time calibration that Olga will explain later, I think. And in here we have a picture of the place where we set the method. So we saw this yesterday with some people also. In a non-scheduled method, we have a column in here, which is the dwell time. Okay, and then we cannot change the cycle time. Okay, the cycle time is fixed because all the time it's doing the same, all the transitions. In the case of the scheduled MRM, instead of having here the dwell time, we have the retention time. And then we fix the scan time. Okay, we say we want a cycle time of 1.2. Then in each moment of the chromatography, the software calculates how many transitions are coeluting, and it divides the time that it has into the different transitions. Okay. So the dwell time will change from transition to transition. This is another tool that you have in Skyline, in which you can see how many transitions are coeluting in a particular time. So this is very useful because, as I told you before, so we don't put a time, we put a window of time, no? So depending on the size of this window, we can have more or less concurrent transitions, okay? So in this case, with a 2 minute window, the maximum transitions that we have is 60, which is nice because we can have a decent cycle time with that. And with different windows, we have, if the window is higher, we will have more concurrent transitions at a certain time, okay? So this is something to check when you're preparing your method in a scheduled mode, how many transitions you have in a particular time. Because it can happen that if you put a very wide window, you have a lot of concurrent transitions in a particular region of the chromatogram. Then maybe you have to split the experiment in two methods or try to reduce the size of the window in scheduled mode. So the advantage, as I said, is that you have more dwell time for each transition, but this has a limit, up to 200 milliseconds. So the instrument does not allow you to record because you don't gain more sensitivity if you record more than 200 milliseconds. And in the case that you have very few transitions and the cycle time is enough to have this at 200 milliseconds, then what it happens is that the cycle time is shorter. Okay, so you have more data points, which is also an advantage. So in a scheduled mode, either you have more sensitivity or you have more accuracy. So in here, we have set up a target scan time of 1.2, but as in this area, you don't have enough transitions. What it does is that every transition is 200 milliseconds, and it does the acquisition more often. So you have more data points. So, in summary, regarding the instrument, when you perform an SRM experiment, you need to decide which is the dwell time, the cycle time, and the number of transitions per method, because it can happen that you are monitoring a lot of peptides and you need to split the method in several methods, although you are using a scheduled method. Which collision energy formula you want to use? Okay. And if you want to optimize other parameters. And very important also is the chromatography side. Okay, so when we do an experiment, we have two instruments, the mass spectrometer and the LC that it's in front of it. And this part is very important also in order to get a good result. So again, we have a signal and we need to reconstruct this signal. So we need to check what is the peak width in order to know which is the cycle time that we can, it's optimal for your experiment. Okay? So at the end we have signals like this that are not continuous. So you can see in here that this signal is made of joining several points. So if we mark these points, in this case we have 10 points in this peak, which is good enough. But this depends on the width of your chromatographic peak, of course. So for example, in this case, in which we have only 4 peaks, we see that the reconstruction is not good enough, and the quantitation that we are going to have with this cycle time is not good. Okay, now I'm going to explain some basics of chromatography, so this is more illustrative than useful, but well, I think it's appropriate to explain it here. So for some of them it will be very trivial, but maybe for some of you it can be useful. So this is what we have in chromatography. We have a stationary phase, which can be made of different materials. In proteomics, we used to work with reverse phase chromatography, and there are different types of the reverse phase chromatography depending on the hydrophobicity of the stationary phase. So the typical one is C18 for peptides, but if you work with proteins or bigger peptides, maybe you are interested in use another type of stationary phase like C8 or C4. And then we have a mobile phase that goes through this column. That also the standard solvents that we use in proteomics are water as phase A, and acetonitrile as phase B, with some acid that usually is formic acid. Okay, so the analyte, what it does, it is in an equilibrium between the stationary and the mobile phase. And this is, there is this partition coefficient, which is the molar concentration of the analyte in the stationary phase divided by the molar concentration of the analyte in the mobile phase. Then we have the chromatogram, in which we have a retention time, which is the time in which your analyte goes out of the column. And also what we call the dead time, which is this one, which is the time that the and retained mobile phase spend to go through the column. Okay. So what is very important in chromatography is the concept of resolution. So the resolution between two peaks is a measure on how well these two peaks are differentiated in a chromatography. So you have an example in here of very good resolution. We have one peptide in here, let's say, or whatever, and another peptide in here. This is not so good resolution because in here we have some time in which the two analytes goes together from the column. And in here we have an example of low resolution. So the resolution can be calculated between two analytes according to their retention times and the width of the peaks. Okay? And of course, higher values are better. So we want to have high resolution. So to explain chromatography, there is this theoretical plate model in which we divide the column in several plates or layers in which the sample reaches the equilibrium between the stationary and the mobile phase. And then the analytes that are in equilibrium are transferred to the next plate. This is an model to explain how chromatography works, but the plates do not exist, and they are only used to explain the behavior of chromatography. And there is also this parameter, which is called the height equivalent to a theoretical plate, or H, which corresponds to the length of the column divided by the number of the theoretical plates. So the smaller the plate is, the better chromatography efficiency is achieved. And how we can estimate the number of plates? We can estimate the number of plates using this formula that takes into account also the retention time and the width of the pit. This is for a particular analyte. So each analyte will have a different number of plates for the same column. So as we have seen, we have this formula to calculate the resolution, which is based in retention time and in the peak width, but we can also calculate the resolution between two analytes using this other formula in which we include the number of plates of the column for this particular analyte, also the capacity factor, which is another parameter that measures the retention time of a peak, and it's independent of the column geometry, and the selectivity factor that describes the separation of two analytes independently of the peak width. Okay? So this is not that important for you. What is important is that we want to maximize the resolution, and for doing that, we need to maximize each of the terms of the equation. And how can we do that? Okay, for doing that, we can increase the number of plates, reduce the height of these plates, or increase the selectivity or the capacity factor. And how is this translated to real life? So to real life, what we are going to play with is with a column dimension, with the particle size of the stationary phase and the pore diameter, with the flow, and also with the gradient and with the solvents. So the column dimension, it's important. So usually the columns are coded with the internal diameter, which is the first number, and the length, which is the second number. So this would be a standard size for a proteomics experiment, 75 micrometers of inner diameter and 15 centimeters of length. But in general, for chromatography, this can be very variable. So you can have from 50 micrometers to 4.6 millimeters or even more. Okay, these are examples of different types of columns that are more for other applications. In our case, when we do nanochromatography, we are in this range. Okay. Although some people also do microchromatography coupled to SRM because it's more robust. If you have ever worked with nanochromatography, you know that it's a delicate technique that you need to be very careful that when you have a leak, it's hard to know what it is. And well, some people, they use microchromatography. The sensitivity lowers a bit, but the system is more robust. So for example, the people that are working with plasma, that they need to run thousands of samples or so, they tend to use this microchromatography. But well, in this course, we are not covering this topic. We are just going to talk about this nanochromatography. Regarding the length, it's also important. It can go from 2 centimeters for a pre-column, for example, to 1 meter. So long and thin columns are better because they give better resolution, and the reason for that is that they have more theoretical plates. Okay. Regarding the particle size and the pore diameter, the particle size can range from, well, less than 3, from 1.9 to 50 micrometers, being 3 and 5 the most common particle size for proteomics applications. And the particle pore size, it can range between 100 and 1000 angstrom, being 300 angstrom the most common value for proteomics applications. This is something that also, when you describe a column, you describe the column length, the internal diameter, the particle size and also the pore diameter. Okay. So the smaller particles and small pores gives better resolution, but you have a problem. It's the pressure, because they give a very high back pressure. So depending on the LC system that you have, it can be that you cannot work with a long volume because the LC is not able to deliver the mobile phase at that pressure. Okay. Another factor that influences the chromatography is the flow. The plate height and also the peak width is related with different phenomena that occurs that are somehow more or less related with the flow. And these are path diffusion, longitudinal diffusion, and mass transfer. Okay, we're gonna go through these phenomena. The first one is the path diffusion, which is independent of the flow. And what happens in a chromatography is that every molecule take different paths through the column. So the length of these paths, yeah, so you see here, this is one molecule that goes very straight. This other one takes a longer way, and this other one makes even a longer way. So most of the molecules travels with a similar path length, but some of them are a bit slower, like the red ones, and some of them are a bit faster. So that's why we don't have a line. That's why we have a peak, okay? And this peak is Gaussian in shape. The other phenomena that occurs is the longitudinal or random diffusion, that the analyte continuously diffuses from the center of its zones to another part of the stationary phase. This is related with the flow, because the greater the flow rate it is, the less time the analyte spent in the column and less diffusion occurs. Okay. But the other phenomena, which is a mass transfer, is the other way around. So the lower the flow, the higher it is. So the solute passes through the column, and then it needs to reach the equilibrium. So there is an equilibrium between the mobile and the stationary phase. But as the mobile phase is moving, this equilibrium is broken, and you need to reestablish the equilibrium with a mass transfer from the stationary to the mobile phase. And then the equilibrium is recovered, but now the peak is broader. So we have this other equation in which we relate the height of the plate and then the resolution of the chromatography to these three factors that we have seen. So as we have seen, the first one was independent of the flow, the other one was increasing with the flow, and the other one was decreasing with the flow. So at the end, we have an optimum flow, which depends on the column diameter. Okay, and this is something that is well studied. And here you have a table with different internal diameters and optimal flow rates for each of these internal diameters. No. For example, in our case, for a 75 micrometer column, that's what we use. Usually, 250 nanoliters per minute, it's the ideal flow. Okay, so probably the flow, you are not going to change it, because this is something that it's well studied. And the other thing that you can try to change is the gradients that you use, and also the solvents. So longer gradients normally results in better peak resolution, as it is shown in the picture. But too long gradients may favor this diffusion that we were explaining and then the peak are broadening. So also we cannot put a forever gradient because we are gonna lose resolution on this side also. Okay, so now I'm gonna explain some examples in which we are using, these are examples from our laboratory. Some time ago, we were using this type of columns, 12 centimeters and a particle size 3 micrometers. And now we have implemented these long columns with a small particle size. And these are the same analyte, the same sample acquired in this with these two different setups. So in the case of the heavy reference, we don't used to have so much problem because we used to have them in high amount. So we have both, in both cases, a good signal to noise, although you can see here that we have a higher intensity because the peak is it's smaller. But in here, if you look at the endogenous peptide, you can see that with this setup, we have a much better noise separation. Here we have some interferences that can affect quantitation, and in here we have cleaned the peak and we have a better resolution. We have another example in here in which we had an interference in this setup which can be resolved in the long column setup. In here you have a zoom. So you see here that this peak in here, this is not, this is probably a part of the signal is due to our transition, but part of the signal is due to an interference because it does not follow the exact profile of the other transitions. So with the long column, we are able to separate this interference and we will have much better quantitation. This case. Another example in which we see the same. So we have an interference in here that it's much well separated in the long column. One thing that we need to take into account when we work with this type of columns is that the width of the peak is going to be smaller. So in here, in the 12 centimeter column, we have a peak width of 21 seconds. And in the long column, we have a peak width of 12 seconds. So this is to obtain the same number of points per peak, we need to work with the smaller cycle times. Okay. So all these things that we have seen about chromatography are, well, that we need to reconstruct a signal that it is important the resolution, how well separated are our analytes. To explain all these phenomena, we have this theoretical plate model that tries to fit into the chromatographic behavior. But at the end, what we will play is with these parameters, which are the column dimension, the particle size, and well, the flow rate, as I told you, it's pretty well established depending on the size of the column. And we also can play a bit with this gradient and solvent things. But you need to keep in mind that every project is different and requires to optimize different parameters. And our general aim will be to achieve the maximum sensitivity and the quantitation accuracy. And that you need to optimize your needs according to sample and instrument time availability. Because, of course, to do the perfect experiment in the paper can be easy, but then you need to take into account how many hours of instrument do you have, how many sample do you have, and how you can optimize all these values. So this is not, if you ask me which is the best cycle time, I cannot answer this question. Depends on your chromatography, depends on the number of peptides or proteins that you're monitoring, and so. You need to study this before starting your experiment and your acquisitions, okay? Well, and with this, I finish my presentation, and I want to thank Ariel and Eduard for some of the slides of this talk.